following interview was conducted with Eva J. Goble for the Purdue University History Program. It took place on Friday, January the 12th, 2007, at her place in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the oral history librarian, and also Valerie Yazza, the one of the diversity fellows. Welcome. We're going to start. Valerie's got. We're going to continue on. This is part two of the interview.
I'll start with the board that you served on.
What?
For the board. Just like the Federal Extension Economic Opportunity Task Force.
Oh, the extension. That's what we called ECOP, Extension Organization and Policy. And that was a national organization. So what we talked about, everybody used all over the United States. And so we met different states and had quite a conversation. Sometimes useful and sometimes not. But it was interesting. That's what we called ECOP, Extension Organization and Policy.
I have some other boards that you served on, Purdue Faculty Executive Council and the Governor's Council on the Status of Women.
I was on the Governor's Council for the Aged. I can't remember. Status of Women, I can't remember that I was. I was on a Governor's Council for the Aged and Aging, and Maurice Enright was the chairman. He came from Bloomington, and since that time, they've built a center down there, and they got the money from the National Council for the issue. But the status of women, I don't think I was on that. I think Kathleen Johnson was. I would have been glad to be on it.
What kind of work did you usually do on these boards?
Well, State Council for the Aged. You've seen all these houses, apartments in different towns that have been built for older people. That's us. We got them built. And there's one in Delphi, and there's one almost every little town all over the state. Crawfordsville, every place. So a lot of older people live in that housing. That was one of the reasons I was interested in this place. Wanted to see how it worked.
Is there something that sticks out in your mind when you served on those boards? Something memorable? One of your favorite boards that you worked with? In the first interview, we were talking about the cooperative house, and that was the Twin Pines Cooperative here on campus. The sponsor was the Home Demonstration Association. Would you be able to tell us a bit about that association and the kinds of things they did?
Well, we had job of getting it done, which I was glad to do. And I started out encouraging the women to contribute whatever they felt they could. And some of the women could only afford 25 cents a year. But they said in 4 years, that's a dollar. Now, a dollar looks like chicken feet today. That day, a dollar bought a lot of things for your family. And they did it until they acquired $30,000. And they said, what do we do now? And I said, well, we have to have a house. So they began to look at property. And of course, things were pretty low economically. So we found a house in Walton Street. And they bought it. And the next step was, how do we redo it so that girls can't live in them? And I went to see R.B. Stewart because R.B. always was able to take a problem and say, you can do this, and you can do that, and talk to your women, see what they want to do. And so we decided that the thing to do was to let him buy the house. We gave him the money to buy the house, and the specialist in our department who worked at that time were Hutchison and Martha Jo Bentley, and the supervisors redesigned how it could be organized for 29 girls. And R.B. told the physical plant, go ahead and do what those women want. And we did, and it turned out beautifully. Now, I expect that $30,000 house is worth $250,000. And the girls are in the process of selling it and moving out and building a new house. Now, they did it by cooperating. They applied. At first, we nominated girls from the county. And we used to have a woman from Hendricks County who was instrumental in it. She was very erect and a big bouffant of white hair, always beautifully dressed. And she'd say, look at the application. She'd say, oh, this girl is such a pretty girl. Let's take her. So our biggest problem was to find out how to get Mrs. Van Nuys to see. And she had to look to see, was this the kind of girl that needed some assistance? And would she go to college if she didn't? Yeah. County. But this is what I spot.
Your extension service. You were state leader of the extension service from 1947 to 1973. What were some of the activities in which you were engaged in?
Actually, it was mostly administrative work. And during that time, I was on several national committees. On one committee, I was educating young people for federal service, for government service. And ECOP, of course, was another committee that took a lot of time. And locally, I dealt with problems in any department. Had people that weren't helping deciding what to do and what they can't do and that sort of thing.
So you were located on campus? Were you located on campus?
Yep. But I wasn't here very much.
Were you in the cooperative extension office? Is that where you were?
Yeah. No. I was, well, after being state leader, I was the assistant director. And the extension people have a nice sense of humor. They call me Miss Director.
We took some time to read the booklet that you handed us on the extension service. There was a comment in the section at what you were most proud of in the extension center, in your extension career. What were some of the programs you handled to give group leadership training and skills?
Well, we trained about 3,500 leaders each year. That's a big job. And when I say train, they trained us as much as we trained them, because this was a period of time when women were just beginning to think, well, I could do something else besides being home all the time. And they had ideas. I think the way they made the Twin Pines goes tells you how much effort they put into it. And of course, we have leader training meetings yet, but I don't know many groups that train 3,500 people a year.
Let me ask you this. The extension people, this is for our researchers so they understand, they were based in the community. Just give us a couple sentences about that, somebody, so that they understand when we talk about extension.
Well,
clarify.
The Cooperative Extension Service started with the Smith-Lever Act, and I should be able to tell you what year, but I forgot. Was sometime after the Civil War, and the whole purpose was to increase food production because people are having a hard time finding food. And of course the crops weren't the massive fields you see today. Most were 10 acres. 15 acres. Anybody had 50 or 100 acres, they were well off. And so the Cooperative Extension Service had all of these specialists, mostly agricultural specialists. But these guys are good. We've got one down the hall here. He's other way. And we've got lots of them.
You mentioned that there was the oral history project in the Extension Homemakers Association.
Yeah.
Is that still going on today?
Well, it's finished now. I gave Sammy the books. Mm-hmm. But at the time the elder started out, she started out just the way you're doing here. We helped her locate leaders, and she went out to talk to these people and had them tell what they remembered of early days. And we had a photographer here, a two-generational firm. What was his name? Was it Allen? Allen. And those fellows kept copies of all of this, and they'd take them pictures. Well, the women dug up the pictures. It's a part of their record.
You mentioned also earlier about, you know, you had connections with Ag Econ, with the people of Purdue, and a couple of these names sort of resonated with me, Dr. Bottom and Henry Kohlmeyer. What are some of the things that resulted from that relationship that you had with these people?
Well,
Jay Carroll was an interesting person, wasn't he, from what people say?
Carroll was very interesting and smart. And Heavy was very smart. And Noy was, he had his experience in the county, so he did all right. So I used to travel with them. And they were always, we never spent an idle trip anywhere. Because the minute you got in the car, somebody'd say, well, what do you think's going to happen to the farm income next year? Well, somebody'd say, that can't be right. And we'd argue and talk about that all the way to the next place. Had a good time doing it.
It's a learning experience, too.
Yeah.
Picked up all kinds of information.
Yeah, and I think the one of the trips I remember, they let us go to Washington, D.C. for what we called Outlook Meeting. That's where the people who spend a lot of money and time trying to figure out what the farm outlook's going to be. And what is going to happen to the price of machinery, and price of cattle, price of produce, and so forth. And they sent us to Washington to participate in that conference. And I got to go every year, and it was a wonderful experience. I really think that I got interest in economics throughout the meeting because it made good sense.
And you were familiar because you lived, coming from that background, so it kind of clicked. It resonated with you, which is good. Okay.
Of course, we argued all the way. If we went by train at first because that was before commercial airlines were possible. Before they'd let us fly. And we'd argue all the way on the train. Then the last few years, one time we missed the train. We had to take the train Cincinnati, and we missed our connection. And Carol said, what do you think about Klein? And of course, I was about 28 or 29. I thought it was great. And I said, oh, I think it'd be fine. So we got a reservation on the airplane and flew. And Ronald was sitting by me by the window to protect me, you know, in case we had an accident. And every time we hit a bump, Ronald was ready to drive. I was having a great time. And I think one of the things I've always remembered from that experience was it was at sunset, and as we flew across the country, I kept noticing that the sky was still light. And I looked down at the earth, and it was beginning to get dark. And I thought to myself, there's something wrong with what I learned, because darkness doesn't fall. It goes up because the sun sinks. The shadows come up. And I don't think I'd ever figured that out before. I'd had geography, but I hadn't learned that.
You mentioned to share with us about the home economics involvement with the Brazil project, the school down there. Elaborate a little bit about that.
Well, the school, when Harry Truman was president, he got this Point Four program started, and Harry Reid must have been the year of Harry. Harry Reid said, I'll cooperate for Purdue if I can have Brazil. And they said, well, why do you want Brazil? And he said, because they're the opposite in climate from us. And we could do research down there, the opposite end of what we're doing in here, and I think learn something. So they gave him Brazil, and then they said, what are you going to do for home economics? And he said, well, we'll take that. And at that time, they had a foundation about that high for a school, and it had been about that high for 5 or 6 years.
This is in Brazil?
In Brazil, at Bessosa. And the reason was they didn't have any teachers, so they couldn't see any reason of building without teachers. So, Dean Reed came in to see me and said, now, I don't want you to go, but I want you to find somebody who can do this. And said, from now on, the home economics part's your baby. And so I began to look around, and Amy Kelly over in Missouri, they had just gone through some sort of reorganization, and they had a supervisor who hadn't really got what she'd like to have had. And Amy Kelly said, why don't you interview Anita Dixon? Well, was really the person who made it go. All I did was hire.
Were you the dean at that time? Or
no, I was
in
the state.
State with Extension Service? I see.
Yeah.
Okay. How long is that school? Is it affiliated with a university down there, or what? Whereabouts?
Yeah, it's a part of the University of Sosa, which at the time she went, there was only one girl in the whole school, and that girl was in agriculture.
Did you visit down there? Did you go down there?
Yeah, yeah. But Anita was the one that made it go, because she spent, I think she spent more than 10 years. She spent 5 years, and then she came home and worked for 5 years. Then she went back for 5 more years. And she really put it together.
How long was that contract? Purdue does not have that contract. The school is now functioning separately.
Well, now it's part of the international program.
I see. Okay.
And, of course, the international program is big.
Mm-hmm. But this was a different contract when they went down there.
Oh, this is when we were just feeling our way along. We didn't even know if we could do it.
What was your first look when you went down there? Was it, what was your reaction?
Well, of course, it was fascinating. Because I'd never been to a foreign country besides Mexico. And one of the things that struck me was that Anita had these girls all around her. I mean, she taught them everything she did, she taught them. You know, if they had a picnic, she taught them. If they had a class, she taught them. And one of the things she asked me to do while I was there was to teach them a class in time and motion study, which I'd done my master's in. And I taught a class in Brazil without the language. Somebody translated. And they understood it.
Very good.
They understood it.
What was the facilities like? Would you just stay, how long was your stays down there? Short ones or?
Short ones. And the next time I went, the only reason I went was someone had employed a teacher to help, and she thought that the school ought to be a high school instead of a college level school. And of course, that wasn't what we got the money for. So, and it says, you better come and help me. And I went down and explained to them that we couldn't cooperate to build a high school, but we had money to help build a college. And we didn't have any trouble.
They understood.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
And of course, it's easier. See, it's a lot easier for somebody outside to come in and say, you can't do this way, than to have somebody who's working there to say, we can't do it.
Looking over your long association with Extension in Indiana, what changes have you observed over your long period of being involved in Extension Services?
Oh, I think biggest changes. Had a tremendous change in the abilities of leaders. I mean, after all, people are college graduates, so they
that when you were the dean of the home ec, you brought along your home economic staff. What was the outcome? Was that easy? And how many, they just made the transition from extension over to the school, or how did that, just were researchers, or they just a clarification?
Well, you see, at first we started out as a part of agriculture because we were working home in with farm women. And then as time went by and we got more urbanized, we were working with all levels of people. We had young homemakers who barely knew how to cook. And they wouldn't know how to take care of their children, that sort of thing. So they thought that that extension specialist should really be in the school because they would enhance the school's knowledge of the state. And also the school would give them the latest research possibilities. So we could see that it was a win-win situation.
You served during the presidency of Frederick Covey. Did you interact with President Hubdy? He was president when you were the dean and also involved.
President Hubdy was always a supporter. I could always count him.
I want to ask for just a couple little things there. What would be, if we asked you, what would be an outstanding event in your life? Could you focus in on that? Or the most memorable, one or the other?
Oh.
Take your pick. Or take both. If you'd like to share with us.
Outstanding.
Or memorable.
I've had a wonderful time. I think that's it.
You think of anything specifically that sort of sticks in your mind as a memorable event?
Oh, I think it's memorable to be able to meet so many people and enjoy their company. And to be with women who were leaders. I think the thing that attracted me most to extension was adults. If they come to your meeting, they want to learn something. Now, maybe you don't teach them what they want to learn, but they are there because they want to learn something.
They feel a need for it and they want to.
Yeah.
Valerie and I were going to ask you, now since you stepped down from the deanship, there's one. What sort of activities have you been involved in? Oh. One, of course, is that Eva Goble lecture series, which is very nice. How did that come about?
I don't know how it came about. But
it's been going for some years.
Yeah.
But what are some of the other activities you've been involved in?
Well, of course, I think the thing that I enjoyed most was traveling.
Any specific spot that really caught your fancy more than any other?
Greece. I love Greece.
Did you take a cruise while you were there around the island, the Greek island? Did you do any cruising around the islands in Greece?
Well, we went all over. I think we were in all parts of Greece. But I didn't get to spend as much time as I would have liked to. And of course, I knew Mary Malleus back here. Do you ever know Mary Malleus?
Mm-hmm.
Well, she's in education by herself. Mary Malleus was a Greek woman who ran a restaurant. And she had two children. Her son went to California. He's head of one of the statisticians things. I don't know what. And Phoebe is in Indianapolis. And she does a lot of lobbying with the legislature.
supportive of women and encouraging women. I'm curious as far as what kind of words of wisdom would you give young women today? Probably in college,
in
undergrad or grad school.
Well, I talked to a class over there. I think I'd tell them to decide what they'd like to do and decide to be well prepared for it and then to live their life in such a way that it made a contribution. And also to savor it. I mean, I think the kids, they want somebody to tell them that. You don't just live, you enjoy it. And I think that's pretty important.
Anything that, any questions that you thought that we failed to ask, got any just in summing up, or if you could cover it, anything you'd like to share with us additionally?
Gosh, I wrote it all down, but I think I haven't kept very good records.
But you kept very busy in retirement years, though, haven't
yeah.
you? The travels took a lot of pleasure, yeah. which was really nice.
Yeah. So, I'm not a good record keeper. Jane Ellis always kept records, but I wrote journals when we traveled, but
that's nice.
Yeah, I still have those, but I have to reread them.
We've been asking just to get some, a little bit of a feel. As you know, the transcript's going to be turned over to the archives, the special collection. Any thoughts on preservation or archival? That you sticks in your mind about preserving and saving things today, which you've taken a step because you've been turning some materials over so that future people, just like the ones that are going to use the transcript, can benefit by that.
Yeah.
I think that speaks for that you do have an interest in it and you realize the value and that you're making a contribution to the university.
Yeah. Well, you want people to be able to profit by your experience. That's the main thing. I can't think of any reasons to keep records.
If you have those that you can share with them, something that yeah. pertains to the university that researchers could benefit by, such as your books and things, which is really
yeah.
good.
Yeah.
yeah. Anything in closing that you'd like to wrap up or anything you'd like to share with us?
What? Have a good time.